Straighten up and stay right. Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top. Fly right.
New York, New York, or a village in Iowa. The only difference is the name. If you're alone, whether on Main Street or on Broadway, if you're alone, they are both the same. A town's a lonely town when you pass through. And there is no one waiting there for you. Then it's a lonely town. You and down, the crowds rush by, a million faces pass before your eyes. Still, it's a lonely town, unless there's love, a love that's shining like a harbor.
It's nice work if you can get it, and you can get it if you try. Strolling with the one girl, sighing sigh after sigh. It's nice work if you can get it.
Good evening. I call to order the Lakewood City Council study session of Lakewood, Colorado on October 3rd, 2016 at 7 p.m. Will the clerk please call roll?
Paul.
Here.
Wickman.
Here.
Vincent.
Here.
Roybal.
Here.
Harrison.
Here.
Johnson. Shakti. Abel.
Here.
Coop.
Here.
Franks.
Here.
Gutwein.
Here.
You have a quorum.
Fantastic. Well, I would like to welcome everybody who's here to enjoy this meeting or tuning in on TV. We have an informative presentation, and I just want to mention Mayor Pro Tem Johnson is out traveling and enjoying herself, and Council President Shakti is in CASA training tonight, court-appointed special advocate. So I hope that she enjoys that. That's a great program. So without further ado, we will move into our presentation, which is State of the Courts. We have our chief presiding judge, Ann Stavick. Good evening, welcome.
Good evening, thank you. And I certainly appreciate being here. I want to thank all of you. I appreciate your support and the support of city management also. It has been a very interesting time for the courts and an interesting time across the country because there has been a lot more scrutiny of the courts. I'm certainly going to talk to you about the things that I usually tell you about as far as numbers and what we're doing with cases, but it certainly is a time when I think that we're more part of the national discussion, and I want to make sure that you all understand that. I have no doubt that the people who are looking more closely at the courts have the very best of intentions. I'm sure that the national civil rights groups and the people who really are trying to put us under more scrutiny are very much responding to some tragic circumstances and some things that really do need to be looked at. I also have every confidence that if they look closely at Lakewood, as they are, that they will be very pleased with what we're doing. And I think that what we need to do is educate, and I will be asking all of you to help me do that, but to educate not only about the Lakewood courts, but really about the whole criminal justice system, because I think there are a lot of positive things going on. There are certainly issues, but there are a lot of positive things going on too, and very much good things in Lakewood. First of all, I do want to introduce the people who've joined me here, and I have my Judge Ramsey, actually you were called the Chief Judge this week, that presiding Judge Ramsey. Dan Ramsey has been here for 26 years, and I actually am presiding. It was inside joke there. I certainly appreciate his wisdom and his experience. And then I also have Judge Corinne Flanagan, and she will be here, I believe it's 2 years in December. And we have really appreciated her energy and enthusiasm, and she's brought a lot to the court. I have my excellent management team, and I'm just so pleased at how they energize our staff and what a great group this is. Chief Marshal Mark Dietl, and he has a very well-trained group of marshals. In fact, just a very quick story. With all the things that are going on across the country about overreactions to things going on, that police overreactions, we actually had a man come into the court not long ago, this is in the last couple months, actually carrying a rifle and just walking in looking like he could have done about anything with it. And I really do credit Chief Dietl and his staff and his training for the very calm response. And it turned out he was just bringing it to anyone to turn it over to the police. It never dawned on him that might be a little bit threatening to walk in with a rifle. We are putting up a few more cameras outside the door just to make sure that we have a little bit more warning in case that were to happen again. But they're all CIT trained, which means crisis intervention training, and are used to dealing with people in crisis and people under strain. And so anyway, that has worked very well. And then my chief probation officer, Scott Hefty. And I have to say, with Scott and Mark and then Tammy Smith, who's not here, she had some family issues tonight, They are all so involved in the city and outside the city and the community. And they actually asked me not to run through all of the lists of the committees and boards and groups and things that they're on. And so I agreed to do that. They said it would just take too long. And so just know that they're very much involved in things. Scott's great passion is veterans. And I will be talking about that a little bit more later. But there are a lot of other things that he's involved in. Tammy Smith is really the one who knows everything about the workings of the court. Like I said, she's not here tonight. But she's the one that really has her finger on the pulse of what's going on in the court. And then Norm, of course, is involved in everything. Norm Brisson, our court administrator, involved in everything that all of us do. And he's certainly a huge support to all of us. So we thank him for that.
Welcome to everybody.
Thank you. We really do have an amazing staff this year. The year has gone very, very well. We've had very little turnover. I think one person is leaving because she just had her third baby and wants to stay home to be a mom. But other than that, it's been a very stable, experienced staff. We also are relying very much on interns and volunteers, which is great because we're getting free work out of them. And it's actually really good for them because they're getting wonderful experience. In fact, 6 out of our paid staff actually started as unpaid interns. And so it's really a way for us to try them out and for them to try out what we're doing. And so that's actually worked very well. We have right now 6 college interns, 4 high school interns, and then 5 volunteers. As I said, there is a lot of scrutiny right now. And it's coming from civil rights groups and then others as well. And I just wanted to let you know that we know this is there because we have the records requests asking for a lot of our court records. We're seeing legislation coming through. It's popping up on the media. And then we're also having observers in the court. And this is where I am very proud, because even though the idea is that they're coming in to look for things that are wrong, we have consistently gotten the message back that Lakewood is doing really well and that we actually could be a model for other courts. And so I feel very good about that. We're working with the other courts around the state to try to get consistent standards and try to make sure that the procedures that we do have are really fair. And I think, as I've told you before, I think that the scrutiny can be valuable. I think there's nothing wrong with being able to take a look at ourselves and see if there are ways that we can improve. And it's nice that we have some groups, the state, Colorado Municipal Judges Association. I'm actually the president of that this year, and that group is working very hard to set some standards and procedures. We also have our employee Joe Donaldson, who is the president of the what's called CAMPCA, which is the Colorado Court Administrators Association. And so we're both very much involved in leaders in those groups, and they're the ones that are really looking at practices and making sure that we're doing a good job. I'm not going to spend an awful lot of time on this, because I think I've talked to all of you at different times about what our goals are in the courts. We're really looking for promotion of sound behavior and then also offender accountability. And so the promotion of sound behavior is when we're looking to see the reasons that people are committing crimes, and we address those with substance abuse treatment, mental health treatment, education and job training and assistance. And then also accountability is certainly part of criminal justice. This used to be what criminal justice was all about. It was the fines and the costs, often jail, maybe community service or work crew. We still use those often as motivators, but we certainly try to combine these two so that we're having people be doing better once they go through the system and through the courts. We are, again, focusing on domestic violence more than any other cases, and that is because they are the most serious that we have. They have the potential to be the most dangerous. And I won't spend an awful lot of time talking to you about the statistics, but you can see that our numbers are somewhat down in 2016. These are projected numbers based on where we were in the middle of the summer. I have talked to some of the heads of the police department and talked about why numbers are down, and it's all a bit of a guessing game, but I think that the police department is going through some transition right now as far as retirements, and they've had some huge cases that have taken a lot of the power off the streets, and so the tickets appear to be down. It does seem that this is something that goes back and forth and does fluctuate. As I said, the domestic violence is the very highest priority, and we are absolutely determined that domestic violence treatment and sobriety will be the end results of many of our cases. And this is where we're a little bit different from some other jurisdictions who basically give them a chance on probation. When they fail, they get a lengthy jail sentence, and that's kind of it. We have a policy of not giving up on them, and it sounds kind to the defendants, but you'd be surprised how many of them really beg us to say, can I just do my year in jail and not go through all this? But we have been really proud at the number of successes that we've had. In fact, when I talked to the staff and the managers about kind of success stories or things I could talk to you about, almost anything, every one that I'm going to talk about tonight is just from the last few weeks. And so these things happen often enough that it is pretty common. We had a man, and actually this case is one of the longest ones, because this was a guy who was charged with domestic violence assault in 2009, and he actually got probation in 2010. And I want to reassure you that most of our cases don't just stay on the books this long. But this guy was in his late 40s. He was unemployed, alcoholic. He became homeless after he assaulted his wife because she threw him out. And then we started him on probation in 2010. He would try for a little while. He'd relapse, try again, relapse. And the whole cycle of the homelessness and the alcohol addiction was really hurting him. Each time he messed up on this, we'd give him some jail, so he would have a chance to dry up and be enthusiastic to try again. But any of you who are familiar with addiction probably know that it usually isn't the first time that somebody gets better. Usually you do have some false starts, and it takes a little while. And this case was particularly kind of satisfying for all of us because he finally was sentenced last November, and this time he started really kind of taking it seriously. He got into the substance treatment and domestic violence treatment. All of his UAs since November, except one. There was one not clean UA, but all of them have been clean other than that. And then he completed his treatment. The big thing was the wife that threw him out in 2009 actually brought him back into the house because she realized this time it was for real. He'd quit drinking. And we saw him last week. I actually ended his case early because he'd done so well. And I wish I could describe for you this really pretty big, tough guy who then just broke down and cried and said, I appreciate so much that you guys stuck with me. And I wouldn't be here if we hadn't kept trying over and over again. So it's heartwarming. It's nice. And we do get a fair amount of that. Like I said, probation is focused on domestic violence. We do focus very much on the prostitutes. I think I've talked to you a lot about that and at other times, so I won't get into a lot of detail, but again, very much treatment oriented. And then the juveniles. And I guess this is when I want to address again what some of the feedback we're getting in the press and some of the groups who are saying that they're thinking that the people who are mentally ill don't belong in jail. And that's usually the headline, and I think we probably would all agree with that. I mean, certainly you have somebody who's mentally ill and you want them in treatment. That's the obvious thing that is needed. And most mentally ill adults and juveniles do not commit crimes. And I think that's the other important point, is that most of them are not in our system having committed crimes. But when we do have people who are mentally ill committing crimes, we have to get involved. And I think this is one area where there's a fair amount of pressure to stop the criminal justice system from dealing with people who are mentally ill in ways that we would treat other criminals or other people who are committing criminal acts. And I guess this is where, just having done this for a lot of years and watching what happens in the courts, it just seems so very clear that people with significant mental illnesses can certainly learn consequences and learn how to behave, basically. And so they can, you know, they've got to adjust their behavior to what society needs. And so I guess that I'm very much in the camp of thinking that with consequences and the treatment that is, of course, absolutely critical, that it's not such a horrible place for people to be. And so I know there's an awful lot of reaction to those headlines, and in theory we all agree to it, but I think that it's important for us to have consequences. And again, another case that we've had just in the last few weeks is a woman who, again, she was domestic violence assault, a shoplifter, she'd had protection order violations, she actually even had some traffic cases. And this is often the case, too, that they usually aren't there on just one case when they're this serious. You will have four or five. In 2015, probation started supervision. She had been getting into physical, verbal fights with the father of her children. She had an opiate addiction, which was very serious. She'd been evicted from her home. She was lucky enough to have parents that let her move in with them. But she suffered from mental health and mood disorders. She went into the criminal justice program with the Jefferson Center for Mental Health, and they really worked on moods, her addiction, motivation, accountability, and probation did some just really simple things. This is what I love about how creative they are. We try to encourage them to try stuff out, but we're starting to give out calendars, and she needed to have a calendar, which she hadn't had before, just to keep track of all of her appointments and court dates and the different things that she just wasn't able to do. And something that simple made a big difference with her. She actually, as she went through her DV treatment, ended up getting pregnant again, and decided that she needed to, well, she was encouraged to get into residential treatment. She's finished that up now, is having a very healthy pregnancy, has become what looks like a good mom. I mean, she's really gotten through the worst of her addictions from what we can see, has been a shining star in her domestic violence classes. And again, this is somebody who really has had some significant mental health problems. And it seems that when they understand how things need to be, that they often respond really well to that kind of reaction. Now, the municipal courts, I think, are so much better than other courts in handling certain kinds of crime. There's no question that the state courts ought to deal with the really dangerous people. I mean, they have the resources, they have the, you know, lot longer sentences, they can do much more with the more serious offenders. But the municipal courts are the ones that have, I mean, our most serious cases are their least serious cases. The ones that we're spending our time on and that we're able to give resources to are people who would probably get just a very little glance in the state courts. We also are looking at a lot of quality of life type crimes, and you all as city council decide what you want to see in your communities. You're responsive to the citizens of Lakewood, and the different cities are very different. That's what's been interesting working with the other judges around the state, is that we see that there actually are very different problems and different responses in various municipalities, and it's not that one's necessarily right or wrong. We just have a different community, and that's where you as city council can respond to your constituents, and then you've got the police and the courts who can know the community better and get the programs and the kinds of things set up that that really can help. When we talk about the quality of life crimes, they're not crimes that would be necessarily dangerous. I mean, the drunken, disorderly person who's screaming and yelling out on the street isn't maybe that dangerous, but he's really driving everybody crazy. Just like the person who's doing a lot of graffiti and smashing windows. Again, you know, the neighbors want to have those things taken seriously. The person who's urinating on the bus stop. It's not really hurting someone, but that has to stop. So it's these kinds of crimes that the municipal courts can take seriously and that I imagine you hear about too. And so that really does show that there's a niche for us. There's a niche for what we do. And this really, I think, is the essence of home rule. And I know that we'll be talking a lot about that this year. But home rule is something that is at least being discussed a lot as to how much cities ought to have control over the behavior of their citizens and how they're responded to. And so I think it's just worth all of us having these discussions and thinking about what that means. And I'm a firm believer that this is a good place for us all to be. And this does bring me to another story. We often know the people we're dealing with, and we have a man who has just gone off to Fort Lyon, and some of you may be familiar with this. It used to be the VA hospital out in, is it Bent, Colorado? And they've turned it into basically a treatment facility for the homeless. It's way out in the country, and so they're removed from the communities where they might be influenced. And it's actually been very successful. It's voluntary. They have to agree to go there. But we had a number of police agents that focused on this particular gentleman. He'd gotten 7 Lakewood tickets in 4.5 months just this year. He also had tickets in Jefferson County and Golden and Wheat Ridge, and these were from, you know, everything from shoplifting to trespassing to disorderly conduct. The police actually really did a good job coordinating with each other, making a lot of notes, making it clear that this is one of our frequent flyers. And so the response then with all the jurisdictions was to be able to get him into this program. We got a bed for him. And just last week, his probation officer showed us a letter that she got from him. And it's very short. It said, "Hello, Jeannie, hope all is well. It's 2 weeks been here and all is well. Hanging in there, no jail for me. I gotta remember that and will do my best to stay positive. Anyway, thought I'd drop a letter and let you know. Thank you." And I mean, just the fact that he's writing that within a couple of weeks was really fun. These charts I've shown you before, and they basically break down what we do. The adult penal cases, the domestic violence cases, and the juvenile, as I've said, are the ones we spend our time on. We spend very little time on the traffic offenses and infractions, but this gives you just a little breakdown of what the cases look like. Now we have probation that covers a good portion of our domestic violence cases and prostitution, juvenile, and in the more serious cases, but the vast majority of our criminal cases actually don't go to probation. And really, probation is very busy and they just don't have time for them. And the big numbers that we have that don't usually go to probation unless they're quite serious, so probation would certainly take them if we asked them to, but are the shopliftings. And as you can see, those numbers have gone way, way up. I have to give a lot of credit to the city attorneys, and point out that we actually do the same kinds of interventions with the cases who are not on probation. Obviously, they don't have the supervision, but we try to determine why they're committing the offenses, and we try to get them into mental health treatment or drug and alcohol treatment, or just give them classes or consequences. Obviously, we use the fines and, if appropriate, the jail sentences too, but then the city attorneys are the ones that actually are calling the treatment providers, and they're making sure that they're coming in and doing what they're supposed to be doing. So I have to really thank the city attorney's office, because they go really an extra mile to make sure this happens. And I do talk to people in other jurisdictions who say, well, we don't have a probation department, so how could we ever keep track of people? How could we get them into treatment? And I have to point out, well, these cases are really held by our city attorney. They're really taken care of by the city attorneys. And you just have to have a really good city attorney's office that's willing to put in the time for that. We also, the other big focus for us, and so much of this is brought on with Scott Hefty, though I should note Mark Dietl's also a veteran, is focusing on the veterans. We have our veterans process, and this is actually, it's a very small program. We only have 5 to 7 veterans on this program at any given time. And we have the retired chief district court judge, Steve Munsinger, running this program. He was very excited to come in and do this. He's a Vietnam vet, and was very excited to be able to get involved in helping veterans. There are only 5 to 7 veterans on this at any one period of time, because so much is done for them. They really are taken by the hands, and they try to help them navigate the resources, get to the VA, make sure that if they're homeless, that they're at least trying to start finding them places to live, looking at substance abuse, education needs, job needs, and really working hard to get them back on their feet. Again, just in the last couple of weeks, we've had a very successful female vet who went through this program, and she actually came to the Veterans Fair, which was just, was that 2 weeks ago. She had had a very severe alcohol problem and was homeless and committing a lot of crimes. It had gotten to a very desperate situation for her. Scott Hefty, the veterans process folks, got together and arranged for her to go from the jail, where she'd been spending a fair amount of time because of all the offenses she'd been committing. They kept her in the jail until they had a bed ready. Well, the bed was in South Dakota. And they actually had to arrange to get her out of the jail. She had a sex offender who'd been very attentive to her, who was waiting for her to get out. They worked with the jail to kind of sneak her out the back door, got her into a vehicle. And this is all with her. Yeah, she wanted to do this. She was ready to do this. So it's not as though they're kidnapping her. But they got her out the back door so they could avoid, she could avoid this man who was really a problem in her life. And then one of the people who worked with one of the agencies actually drove her to South Dakota and got her hooked up in this treatment facility. And she stayed there for a while, completed it, came back. She actually relapsed, which was very upsetting for everybody, but it was a quick one. And she, again, with the support of the veterans process folks and the people around here, was able to recover again. And she was at the fair and just doing great and very excited, and said that, you know, she's taking it a day at a time, but she was very, very grateful for the help that she'd received. The Veterans Fair, I know you all have heard a fair amount about this, and that was a huge success. We had over 40 exhibitors who came, offering all kinds of resources for the various veterans that were there. The Mayor Paul was there, and Councilman Roybal. In fact, I hope you're not going to be mad at me about this. It was interesting because they had a number of different groups and people offering different services, and one of them was that they were giving out flu shots. So I couldn't resist showing you that Councilman Roybal took advantage of the flu shots. But that does give you an idea of how, I hope that's okay, how varied this was and how many different services they actually had for everybody. So that was a huge success. Another thing that happened, and this is stepping a little bit away from the promise I made that I wasn't going to talk about all the specifics that any of the managers have done, but the veterans process that we've been talking about applied for a grant with the Veterans Passport to Hope, and they were actually granted the $5,000 check. And that's going to be put toward things like the transportation and just different kinds of expenses that we can help the vets with. We're also getting a whole bunch of little backpacks for the homeless vets that'll have the toiletries and just really basic kinds of things. And so it was a real honor to get that that grant. And they looked pretty closely at our program, and I think it spoke volumes to the fact that we actually got that. So we're very proud of that. We're still doing the risk assessments with the juveniles, and I don't want you to try to decipher this. I know I've shown you these charts before, and part of it is I just think that it's kind of pretty and looks cool, but it also shows how much the probation department really does focus on the risk factors with kids and juveniles, and we do very, very little with low-risk kids who are going to be okay anyway. And so they get a very small little consequence, usually no criminal history, almost always no criminal history. We move them in and out and don't see them again. And that's definitely the case with the low risk. It's often the case with the medium risk, and you can see that's our largest group. And so, you know, too much supervision, too many consequences have been shown to actually have adverse effects. And so we're very much following the research with this. And then we're able to focus our time and energy on the kids who really, really need it. And so this risk assessment has actually been really valuable. I'm not going to run through all these. I think that all of you have heard me talk about the different juvenile programs. We love talking about them. A lot of them you can visit. So if you have more interest, please let me know, and we'd be happy to get into those more. One of the things I will mention is that our YET program, is the Youth Educational Team program, is now open to the public. And we've been getting such good feedback on this quarterly program. We have this for an evening every quarter. And all the different groups that come and speak and talk to the kids and their parents about the resources, it's just been very effective. And in fact, we hear at the end of these evenings how people just didn't know how many free things there were, how many resources there were. Kids who never thought they could go to college because they dropped out of high school get really encouraged to try that and look at those different options. And so this has been a really fun, successful program. We're still doing a lot with our graffiti cleanup, and I won't run through the numbers, but we've responded to a lot of the city requests for service, and we've also received some nice feedback. In fact, Shane Littleton is the one that runs this program, and he got such a nice note from our 86-year-old citizen who had a bunch of kids come over and clean up a really big mess in her yard. And she just said that it was an unbelievable kind of work that was done, and she felt so good about being respectable again, that her yard looked respectable. But she was really very thankful thankful for the work that Shane had done. They see places like this or hear about them and then turn them into clean looking places like this. So the other The other consequence I just want to touch on is our residential work crew. And as we're doing more or less and less of detention for kids, that really has become rare. The beds aren't there for us if we wanted to use it, and we're just finding that we have more success not locking kids up, and the research shows that that's appropriate too. So residential work crew has become really our go-to consequence, and I thought you might like to see the picture of the outdoor lab that they stay in and they clean. And I also want to really thank you, because it's been the city who's approved money so that the kids who are indigent can have help with that $85 fee that covers the whole weekend. And so for a while there, it wasn't a very good consequence, because we just, you know, the kids who really could use this kind of intervention couldn't do it. And so it's you all who made this happen. And that's actually been just a really good amount for us to be able to open it up to anybody who needs it. So that's been very much appreciated. And then the counselors who are up there are really into helping the kids. So even though they work them really hard, there's an awful lot of mentoring and intervention that goes on. And even though it's supposed to be a consequence, the kids often come back and they thought it was pretty cool and pretty fun, and that's okay. I mean, as long as it's positive, then that's all right. I did want to talk a little bit more about what has been going on, and just to give you a heads up on what we're going to be looking at. I think what we're going to be hearing a lot about, again, it's going to be home rule that'll be discussed. And it really is going to be you all who make some big decisions or have a lot of discussions about what the role of a city ought to be and what the role of city government ought to be compared to other governmental entities. I do want you to know that we actually have started all this kind of self-examination and kind of a critical way of looking at what we're doing. We started all that well before all this came up, but we do have some new things that are going on. The First Judicial District has a best practices team, and they decided, like a lot of other jurisdictions, that they wanted to look at minority overrepresentation in the criminal justice system. And it's apparently there, but we're collecting the data to confirm that. And then once we're looking at the data, we're trying to figure out at what point are decisions being made that would cause this to happen, and what can we do to basically address the issues. And this is where Judge Flanagan and Chief Deedle have both enthusiastically agreed to be on this committee for the county, and the county asked Lakewood if we would be sort of the guinea pig. And so the police department has also been very involved in this and wanted to make sure that that things were being done right in Lakewood. And so we've had so far over 100 kids fill out a survey that just gives us the basic information that we'll use as data to go forward. So Lakewood is instrumental and kind of the leader in getting that done. We're also starting actually just today to do evaluations, which I always feel like I need to remind you that our clients don't come voluntarily. So this is always makes me a tiny bit nervous, because I think, well, you know, it's not like they're coming to have fun in the courts. But we've actually, the last few years, had really pretty good results. I think 83% so far over the last couple of years have rated their experience in the courts as either good or excellent. And so we always do get a couple that are mad at us, but I figure it's good to be asking the questions. And then sometimes we get really interesting feedback where we can actually respond to issues that we may not have thought about. And we've just started that. I believe it's the third year. We've just started that again today. We are, at the request of the governor's Interstate Compact Office, Lakewood, and I'm on this committee, Lakewood is the municipal court who's going to try to comply with the Interstate Compact regulations that are nationwide. I won't get into a lot of detail on this. It's actually kind of complicated, but it's the reporting procedures that the states have with one another, so that if a dangerous offender goes from one state to the other, they're supposed to tell the receiving state who this is, what they should be doing with them. And the municipal courts have not been a part of that. Traditionally, there are some difficulties with it, and so we have volunteered to give it a try and to try to work through the procedural difficulties to be a part of that. And so again, if we can work that out, I think that's something else that the rest of the state will probably follow along with. We are addressing the House Bill 161309, which requires public defenders for people in jail on their first court appearances. And I've said this till I'm blue in the face. We like having public defenders. We like having people represented by counsel. It is absolutely fair. And we have always appointed public defenders for indigent offenders who are looking at the possibility of jail time. And so obviously if they're in jail, that's certainly a possibility. What this bill did was to require the public defender to be at the very first appearance. So prior to knowing if they actually wanted a public defender, prior to knowing who was going to be in the jail on that day, because they often try to get them into jail advisements, which we do on video, as soon as they're arrested. And so basically what this requires is having a full or an attorney there every single day to see if somebody comes in that meets the requirements under this House bill. Like I said, we are really delighted with having public defenders, but this is really expensive, and it's going to cost the city quite a bit of money just to always have an attorney on call. We were asking for maybe 24 hours, you know, if we could just appoint the attorney and then have him be there the next day. We very, very often let people out of jail the first time we see them anyway. I mean, that's the PR bonds, personal recognizance bonds, when they get out on their own signature, are very, very common. And so, you know, there were a lot of things that we were suggesting to try to avoid these costs. We are working with the Colorado Municipal League on trying to figure out how we could maybe share public defenders or see if the state will help us with these costs. And I guess the headlines have been sometimes frustrating, because it makes it sound as though we are trying to you know, basically put people in jail without representation. And I just want to assure you that there is nothing further from the truth, that we absolutely aren't doing that. It's just a matter of that timing and the expense, which I think you know, the cities have been very willing to put up pretty big expenditures for public defenders. It's just we want to make sure that it's being spent smart, in a smart way, when they're actually needed. The other bill that was passed this year that's had a big impact and will probably have a pretty big impact on revenue is that we're no longer allowed to issue warrants or basically have jail time for people who fail to appear for court if what they're not doing is making payments. And so we're sending cases to collections. We've understood that this is what the legislators wanting us to do, and that's fine. We've worked pretty hard to comply with this and to comply with the spirit of this law. We had about 700 warrants out for people who had not shown up for their court dates. And just to make it clear, when somebody has a court date where they're supposed to pay, it's usually a court date where they can come in and tell us that they're having hardship, and we always give them more time. And so they have the right to a hearing on hardship. If they can't pay, we give them a different kind of sentence. And so it's a situation where they would have had that hearing, and when they fail to appear, we always call them. We don't issue warrants until they've had notification a couple times, and then once they really are basically blowing it off, then we used to do arrest warrants, and that's not happening anymore. We'll see how that impacts it. I'm not really giving you a yay or nay on whether it's a good idea or not. It's what's happened, and that's fine, and we're complying with it and have worked very hard to comply quickly with it. And I guess my final thought is just that I'm, in looking at what our goals are as far as community safety and fairness and wanting to provide the best services for Lakewood and for the community, I'm very proud of what we're doing, and I have very much appreciated your support for all of this. We have a lot of freedom to try things at the municipal court level, and our juvenile mental health court was one of the things. I think we were the first municipality in the state to try a juvenile mental health court. That was based on the Sebesky School, which is the Jefferson County School for Kids with Behavioral Issues. Sebesky moved to Wheat Ridge, and so we were thinking, well, we probably won't need that anymore, but as we've looked at the kids who are coming in, we realized, no, we really do need an intensive supervision mental health court for kids. And so now we've opened it up to the other kids, mostly from Lakewood, but who've committed crimes. And so that our juvenile mental health court is going strong. It's still full. We always seem to have a few kids that are kind of on the waiting list, waiting to get in. And again, looking at just in the last couple weeks, we had, actually this was just last week, we had a little boy who was 10 when he started with us. It just turned 10, in fact, and so was very, very young. He came in with three different cases. He was destroying classrooms, smashing walls, assaulting teachers. This thing was throwing desks at teachers, and just utterly out of control, was in a total rage. His mom had lost custody over neglect and probably child abuse, so we didn't know that, but when he was just a baby. And then out of the 10 years that he'd been alive, his dad had been in prison for 7 of those. And so just as he came into our court, his dad got out of prison and was on parole and starting to be involved in his life again. He'd been living with his grandmother. So we got him for these three cases, and I have to admit, it was discouraging thinking it just looked really difficult. We got him into good therapy, and we gave him very, very clear expectations, and okay, you're not to hit people, you can't throw things, and then it turned out that he really responded well to rewards. And so we have a bag of, you know, kind of silly little plastic toys. And when he would do well, and sometimes his doing well was not what you might think of as being well behaved, but for him, just, you know, not assaulting someone during the day or not having these rage-filled episodes was doing well. And so he started really responding well to the reward system. For the last 6 months, have had just great behavior out of him. And he has been able to stay in the regular school. When we got him, they were saying, okay, the public schools can't handle him, or the regular public school couldn't handle him. And he's actually been doing so well that his teacher, who I have to give a lot of credit to, too, that she was willing to work with us and really try to be consistent with him and all this behavior modification. But he's staying in the school, and he's really proud of himself. And it's been fun because his dad, on parole, has really responded so well to all this, too. We had such a happy hearing last week with him getting a certificate and big smiles. And you know, life may not be easy for him, but it looks like he may be able to follow the law in such a way that, you know, that he may be successful. So that was really fun and exciting, and his case is closed, and So I think we're doing a lot of good things, and like I said, I appreciate your support, and I'd certainly welcome any questions you might have.
Great. Thank you, Your Honor. We appreciate all that you do and your staff. It's really cool to go out and talk to other communities and hear about, you know, what Lakewood's doing, and a lot of folks look up to us. I would just remind some of the my colleagues up here that the House Bill 16-1309, we did send a veto request to the governor for that, and we were denied that request, and a lot of the grounds on that was an unfunded mandate by the state of Colorado. So we'll continue to work with that. I know the Judges Association is working with CML, and we're going to see if we can revisit that this year. But that's kind of where that went, and that went fast and furious as well. It was somewhat surprising to see how fast that moved, and we didn't have a lot of luck even with our own legislators here in the city of Lakewood. Couple questions for you. You list other as far as offenses or in your list. So what does other cover?
Let's see.
And there's not a lot. I think it's like 40 or less.
I was gonna say we've got a pretty good list of crimes and things. Other would probably be the disorderly conducts and the harassments, resisting arrests, making false reports to police, trespassing. There'd be a whole list of them. They're different crimes that kids tend to do more. We get a lot of disorderly conducts with them, though plenty of adults do get into fights with each other. Sure. And so that would be another one. Certainly assaults that aren't domestic violence, obstruction of police officer, failure to obey police officers. So a lot of kind of public order crimes and things like that. I don't know if the zoning and the dog cases and those, I think those are specifically in there.
So yeah.
They wouldn't be the others, so, okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, and then shoplifting, that's been an interesting one that we've watched throughout the years. We saw it increase, and I think at one point we thought when the economy was going down, saw that rise, but I guess it could be the same to be said when the economy is doing so well and folks might be priced out, you start to see. Do you have any idea what's pushing that trend or where that's coming from?
We certainly thought it was the economy. I mean, that's what we'd talked about a few years ago. I hear that there are a lot of people coming in from out of state that don't get jobs right away and find themselves in kind of desperate circumstances. And a number of the shoplifters are in desperate circumstances, and we have the others who do seem to be making a living on it. You can kind of tell the difference, and we treat them very, very differently. You can look at what they're stealing and how much they're stealing and how many people are involved and how sophisticated it is. And so we definitely had a rise of those kinds of shoplifters, too. I'd like to think that we treat them in such a strong way in Lakewood that maybe we push them to other jurisdictions, because those are the ones that we tend to send out to the jail if they look like that's their career. So
then lastly, I would just comment, I mean, you do, people are not there because they want to come to court, and to have 83%, that's pretty telling. So hats off for that. A couple counselors have their lights on. Ms. Franks.
Thank you. First, I wanted to thank you guys for the work you do. We know that several of us here were on the legislative committee, and we did all we could to stop some of these unfunded programs. So appreciate you trying so hard.
I appreciate your support and help. And actually, we're trying to get ahead of the game this time. We're trying to anticipate, and I'm hoping to be able to come to you with some ideas about what we think is coming. So we'll be talking to you.
Well, and I think I know the answer to this, but a couple constituents asked, and so it was mainly about Amendment T, and they wanted to ensure that their vote for yes for Amendment T would not hurt your ability for people. It's the involuntary servitude one, that it wouldn't prevent our municipal court from giving people like work assignments and that type of thing. So do we kind of know where that may shake out for being able to give people like community service work?
You know, I have not looked into that at all. I'm going to look over at my, anything about that or how that would impact us? I will need to look into that and get back to you, as I'm not sure.
Appreciate that. And then with regards to, could you bring up the comparison slide of the, 2012 through 2015?
I think. Norm? Do you mind helping me bring up the comparison slide for the various years? How do you do that?
Thank you, that one, yes. And so I wanted to ask the question, a lot of the constituent concerns that are brought to me are related to animal control. And I see that from 2012 through projected for 2016, it goes down substantially. And you may not have the data behind this, but I wasn't sure if that was just that we have fewer people doing the enforcement, therefore fewer folks coming to, or if that's really a decline, because I'm new to council and I get a lot of complaints along this particular topic.
And I'm gonna have to get back to you on that also. I actually was talking to some members of the police department about all of these statistics, and we talked about that, and none of us were very sure exactly why those numbers were down, but I can certainly look into that more and get back to you, so.
I appreciate that. And the last thing I just wanted to, it's more of a community service announcement. We're seeing a lot of people next door because now people can communicate about every crime. I think it makes it seem like there's this big surge of crime, but I'm talking to everyone out there, don't leave your purse underneath the seat. If they see you, put it in the trunk. I mean, you're just going to be kind of setting yourself up for something. So just be safe out there and make sure that you're keeping your valuables with you or leaving them at home. Thank you.
Ms. Hodson.
I was just going to mention, Councilor Franks, I can ask the animal control folks to give us some more in-depth information as it relates to some of this data. So we'll do that for you, Judge. Certainly.
Ms. Harrison.
I just wanted to say hats off to everybody. You guys are doing a really wonderful job. We really appreciate all the work that you do. And one question I had, where do you get all the paint? You paint a lot of graffiti. Is that something that you would like to have donated? Because I don't know. Well, that was exactly the question I was thinking, because of all the different surfaces you have to paint, to have the different colors would be really difficult. So I was hoping that maybe we had a great solution for my garage. All those paint cans I have sitting there. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
That's not a bad idea, actually. Are there any other questions? All right. Again, thank you very much. Thanks for everything that you do to the team here. I mean, it's a tough job day in and day out, so we appreciate it.
Well, I really appreciate it, and appreciate all your support, too. So,
all right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, that is all that we have, so we will go into reports, and I'll just start. Was able to attend the 70th anniversary of Rockley Music on West Colfax Friday night, and that was a really cool event. And I mean, just to celebrate anything in the city of Lakewood that's 70 years old, that's pretty fantastic considering they were here a long time before we were the city of. So hats off to the Rockley family and all they do. And a cool thing that I learned is they have a Rockley Family Foundation, and since 2009 they've given away over $20 million and instruments and scholarships and things like that to the music community. So just a great community partner, thrilled to have them. First Friday, this Friday in 40 West, come out. There'll be a lot of activities going on, a lot of different places, and should be fun. And I think this is the last coordinated one of the year as we start to maybe see some snow roll our way. I said it. And then council received these, which is really cool, and that is an update on signal timing. And we've talked about this in the past, but periodically we try to work with our partners at Dr. Cog and do all of our main thoroughfares and time the lights. So this one went from Colfax to Hamden, and the performance measures the vehicle travel time, daily reduction 1,882 hours, fuel consumption daily 1,479 gallons, time and fuel costs about $45,000 a day, and goes into a couple other metrics. So that was on Sheridan. Yep. And so the, some of those peak times that they've cut are pretty dramatic, almost 4 minutes in morning peak, over 4 minutes in the evening peak. And then the number of stops they've changed in the morning from 11.7 to 5.5, in the evening 14 to 7. So something that's never done when they calibrate these, then normally they sometimes put other thoroughfares out of whack. And so they're constantly trying to do that. But that is all I have, and I'll let other folks maybe talk about this great event we had called Cider Days, which was a lot of fun as well. I'll start all the way down there with Ms. Gutwein.
Oh, I was going to say no report. So I'll also let someone else talk about Cider Days. Thank you.
Ms. Franks.
Well, I went to Cider Days on Sunday with my husband, and it was wonderful. The line was long, but it was encouraging to see. Bought a lot of really cool stuff to support our vendors, so that was really nice. So I really enjoyed it. Did want to announce that we have our Ward 4 meeting this Saturday. It's from 9:30 to 11 at the Green Mountain Presbyterian Church. And this particular meeting is our candidates forum. And I'll let Councilor Wickman fill in some of the details on that. But we're real excited about that. So we look forward to seeing you.
Mr. Coop, you're not going to tell us about apple pie eating or anything? Okay. Mr. Abel?
No report.
Ms. Harrison.
I just wanted to say, only in Lakewood do you see a traffic jam as a result of geese crossing the street. It makes me proud to know we really take care of our animals. Thank you.
No report.
Ms. Vincent.
No report.
Mr. Wickman.
Okay, if you guys didn't do it, it's left for me for cleanup. All right, cool. The town hall, as Barb mentioned, it's this Saturday from 9:30 to 11. We're going to have the candidates for county commissioner, so it'll be four of those. Then the two candidates for state representative, so a grand total of six. And interest of keeping it logical and sane, if you have questions for the candidates, if you can please, by the way, everyone's invited, of course. If you have some questions for the candidates, if you can please submit them to me ahead of time, I'll try to translate them into English and try not to advocate. On announcements, coming up next weekend, Saturday, October 8th, and Sunday, October 9th, is the city's annual free cleanup day, in which you can bring down your large items and stuff that the trash ordinarily won't take. It includes some electronic items as well, which is always difficult to move. There's a big old long list of things that you can and can't bring, but check it out on the website. But that is from 8 a.m. in the morning until 2 p.m. in the afternoon. And the location of that is at the Jeffco Stadium, which is at 6th and Kipling. So like I said, check out the details. And then final thing, on a sad note, I'd like to say one of the giants of our community passed away. I live in the Green Mountain Estates area, and our community association is a GMCA that some of you are aware of. And a longtime board member passed away recently. For those of us who are familiar with Warren Howard, he has a big white beard, big white hair, and he looks like a dead ringer for Santa. And every year, he is Santa. Well, I'm sad to announce that he did pass away last week. He was on a church trip to Italy, visiting Rome, and in the process, he fell down the steps there at the Forum or something like that. And anyway, he passed away. So we're sorry to see Warren go.
Thanks for sharing that, Counselor. I did not know. That's terrible. Ms. Greer, Ms. Hodson.
Yes, thank you. One quick thing. I'm sad to hear that.
Yeah.
Gosh, he's my neighbor. Yeah. So the police chief recruitment is closed. It closed just a couple of days ago. We've got some good applicants. I met with the executive recruiter today, and we're finishing the process. So I'm really excited about it, and I'll have some more information upcoming for you. So finally closed. It felt like it was open for a long time. So I'm excited about that. Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else for the good of the order? Agent Hunt, thank you for taking care of us tonight. We are adjourned at 8.04 p.m. Thank you.
Baby, it's cold outside. I simply must go.
Baby, it's cold outside.
The answer is no.
Baby, it's cold outside.
The welcome has
How
been
lucky that you
so
in.
Nice and warm.
Look out the window at the storm.
My sister will be suspicious.
Gosh, your lips look
My
delicious.
Brother will be there at the door.
Waves